Thank you. It's a pleasure for me to be here. And I'm coming back again to the conferences in Istanbul. I was present at the first mediation conference after the Finnish-Turkish initiative on mediation. And I'm sorry I'm not in Istanbul itself, because it is a very pleasant city, but we're doing our best. So it's good to be back with you. It's been an exciting conference. I think you've hit very important elements in the problems of mediation, because the situation of mediation is a very crucial one at the present time. There are conflicts going on that have a deep need for skillful mediation, and yet have been elusive and have not been able to be touched by an effective mediation. Places like Nagorno-Karabakh, which has been, after all, almost 20 years in a ceasefire, mediated, but we can't get beyond that. Or places like Afghanistan, where apparently some mediation is bearing fruit, but how much fruit is on that tree, it remains very perplexing and difficult to reach. Or Libya, as Hassan Salameh testified in the second session, where serious problems are brought up by the question of mediation, or South China Sea. With whom does one mediate in the South China Sea? What kind of object do we have of mediation? I think there are real problems that dog these situations, particularly at the present time. One of them is that mediation is not between well-constituted parties, with non-state armed groups taking place in the conflict. It's hard to find a valid spokesman for the two sides. It's hard to find people who will be able to engage in the mediation and then carry out the agreement afterward. A second problem is that in these conflicts, there are no salient solutions. Very often in a mediation challenge, one knows where one wants to go, and the problem is getting there. And I think the situation in Israel-Palestine is such an eloquent testimony of that. We all knew where we wanted to go in the two-state solution, but we have never been able to find an effective way of getting to that. But in the problems that we have today, there is no salient solution. What's the salient solution in Nagorno-Karabakh? A second aspect that's difficult is that the question of letting the fox into the chicken coop. The very party that's making the trouble is a party to an effective reconciliation, and that's a difficult bridge to get over. So the fox in the chicken coop is a difficult problem to the dynamics of the mediation. Yet at the same time, a mediation cannot be, as mediators know, cannot be a suicide agreement. The parties are not going to get into mediation if they understand that it is the end of their existence. And that, as I'll bring up later on, that was a problem that we had in Syria, as the ingredients of the parties did not make for an effective mediation and reconciliation object. Mediation has been talked about as the search for a solution, and all the definitions that we have of mediation talk about it in those terms. As Hassan Salameh said, it's setting up the architecture for a peace process. But there's something before that. That's the second step, largely conceived in a mediation. But the first step is to getting the parties to want to be mediated. The first step of the mediator, the first challenge, is to ripen the parties' conceptions of the conflict so that they want to engage in a talk about how to find themselves a way out of a stalemate in which they are locked, and a stalemate that is painful to them. So I do want to focus a good deal, because this has not been discussed in our talks here this afternoon or this morning. I want to focus on the job of ripening the party's perceptions. The mediator has to get the parties to realize that they are not on a winning course, that there's no prospect for a unilateral solution, that they are in a stalemate, and that both of them are in a stalemate, and not simply a stalemate, because we live with lots of stalemates that we find unattractive, but still we have to face them, but a stalemate that is hurting now, that the prospect of continuing the conflict as it goes is going to be difficult to them. And not only can they not win, but that there is a prospect then of being able to get something out of a mediated agreement rather than one that is pursued unilaterally by the parties. Kofi Annan said, what happened to my face on this picture? Kofi Annan said that a mediator must not want to a solution more than the parties. But this is, oh, that's better now. But this is only part true, or only prematurely true. The mediator must want a solution in the beginning, more than the parties, if the parties themselves do not want to be involved in mediation. Mediator has the job, therefore, of selling that want to the parties before he can talk about the architecture of the of a peace process. And a mediator has a difficulty in this. In some cases, the mediator is invited in by the parties. That's true. And the parties feel a need for a mediator. But in many cases, in this type of conflict that we have today, the parties are not sure that they want mediation at all. In fact, face it, a mediator is a muddler. He's somebody who gets involved where he's not wanted. We'd much rather be able to find our own solutions to conflicts unilaterally on our own terms, and not have a third party mucking around in the conflict that we're enjoying. Not only are we enjoying it as parties to the conflict, but it is often the coin of our acceptance and our popularity at home. After all, the conflicting parties have sold to their people the idea that they are defending proper values. And that defense is often the key to their success. To their tenure in office. They suddenly have to change tactics. They suddenly have to tell the parties that they are no longer involved in a process of winning, but in a process of finding a solution with another party that they have probably, I don't know what's going on, that they have probably engaged they probably caricaturized as an evil enemy. How can they talk to an evil enemy? How can they get themselves involved within a conflict, within a discussion of an enemy that is the coin of their success at home? Well, the mediator must take on that challenge, and must involve itself in an attempt to sell an entrance into the process by instilling the idea that the process is unwinnable. Again, parties very often think not only that they can win it, but that they must win it, that they cannot lose in the eyes of their public, that they are there for the purpose of pursuing that unilateral solution. And so they must have an agreement, that an understanding among the parties that the solution is a stalemate, and that it is a hurting stalemate. Unless they get that understanding in from the parties, in the parties' minds, they cannot then go on to the second step, which is a step of looking for a solution to the situation. There are lots of examples of this problem in practice. There are lots of examples where mediation failed because the mediator was not able to bring to the party the idea that the war was unwinnable and could only be handled by a discussion with the other side. After all, Syria is a situation we've heard Stephen de Mistura, and he and his predecessors, particularly Kofi Annan and Lakhdar Brahimi, trying to tell Assad that he could not win, were kicked out of the office by bringing up that topic. Assad told Brahimi that if he's going to, the solution involves his leaving office, Brahimi ought to get out because he's biased. In the Libyan situation, unfortunately, all of the good mediators, including Hassan Salameh, have not been able to tell the parties that they are in a that they are unable to win, because they want them, not only in their own mind, but with support from the outside, is pushing to win the conflict. Or in Nagorno-Karabakh, the mediator has not been able to get the parties to give up the aim of absolute victory, either absolute membership involvement with Armenia, or absolute return to a position within Azerbaijan. And so the mediation has failed in that case so far. The same kind of situation we have in South Sudan, where the parties are much more, rather enjoy both their tribal support and the money that's coming in the name of aid to enrich their pockets. So mediation does involve ripening the party's perception before they get into a substantive mediation. And this has happened. It happened to a limited degree, but in economic terms, in the Kosovo-Serbia recent discussions. Or it's happened at least in the beginning of the process in Afghanistan. The mediator has been able to ripen the perception that a mediated agreement is better than a continuation of the war. Or even limitedly, if you want, in the discussions between Israel and the UAE and Bahrain. Or earlier in the process in Namibia, where it took 6 years to convince the parties that they were in an unwinnable stalemate and it was better to talk. Or in Alvaro de Soto's work in El Salvador. So the first job of the party, of the mediator, is to ripen the party's perception of their conflict as a stalemate, and a stalemate that hurts them. There are lots of other requirements that have been brought out in the discussion. I'll just highlight a couple of them as I close my remarks. the mediator needs to have unswerving support from the mandator of his mediation job. And that means unswerving support in many cases from the United Nations Security Council, not to bring that support on the members of the Security Council is a diplomatic sin. And we've seen that in cases, for example, as in Syria, where that support was just lacking, the mediation has failed because of its absence. We've seen, and the third session has brought this out as well, that the idea of a ceasefire must apply to the external patrons of the conflict. And Ghassan Salameh emphasized this very strongly in his remarks. To disengage the external patrons of the conflict so that one can talk to the conflict directly, a lesson that came out of the mediation in Namibia back in the 80s. And finally, I think the last session brought forth the idea that IT is very useful in getting additional information for the mediator, and that that information can very effectively be plugged in, best of all, not directly to the mediator, but to the MSU that has been set up very usefully in the United Nations, but that you can't get around the need for direct personal contact. You need face-to-face for mediators to talk to the parties and get the parties together. You can't convince a person sitting behind the protection of a screen. 2,000 years ago, a famous prophet wrote about peace as the breaking down of the middle wall between parties. St. Paul was writing to his congregation in Turkey at Ephesus. And it shows that Turkey has a millennial calling to be a peace factor and a mediator, and that we all share in that rich challenge to make peace through mediation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sarkma. It's indeed better without a mask, and I cannot imagine a more appropriate ending to this long feast of knowledge and experience sharing on perhaps the most intractable and even frustrating of all human endeavors, which is peacemaking. We have almost come to the end of another Istanbul Mediation Conference. It is hard to speak at the end, and after such a star cast, but someone has to do the job of closing this event. So as we come to the end, allow me to recall the context of this conference and hazard a few thoughts on the issues we covered today. Developing strategies for peace is as important as strategies for preserving core interests, core national interests. This is manifest in the efforts we here in this ministry put into promoting mediation. Turkey is currently co-chairing three distinct groups of friends of mediation at the United Nations, the OSCE, and the Organization for Islamic Cooperation. We are the only country doing so. As a result of the efforts at these at the UN group of friends, 4 UN General Assembly resolutions on mediation were adopted, in addition to 2 OIC, Council of Ministers resolutions. These have defined the normative framework, if you will, of mediation. Therefore, the Istanbul Mediation Conferences have pursued 2 main goals since the very beginning. One is, well, since the beginning, we have taken a broad view of the field and looked not just at yesterday and today, but also at the foreseeable future to the extent that is possible. Secondly, the conferences have helped develop policy outcomes regarding those challenges and opportunities. Some of the ideas raised in our conferences have found their way to solid policy outcomes. Until this year, we have been serving those twin goals for fusing thought with practice by bringing people physically together in our beautiful Istanbul, my hometown. However, due to the pandemic, we had to switch to the digital stage this year. One may wonder why we had not postponed this event for this year. The answer is twofold. We went ahead because we could. The pandemic has been a test run for the digital age. It has accelerated the use of digital technologies in international affairs and diplomacy, including in peace processes. But we have the necessary tools to convene conferences like this one and fulfill our role in advanced cognition. But we also went ahead because we should. Every panel has underlined that the need for mediation is even greater amidst the pandemic conditions and presumably after the pandemic as well. Our panels and panelists have sounded a warning that the international community must step up efforts at the peace development nexus. The impact of the pandemic on conflict and peace dynamics was the first question this conference addressed. The coronavirus has accelerated and aggravated existing conflict-related trends and further complicated efforts on the ground. Problems of the international organizations and intensification of big and middle power rivalries marked another such trend that only got worse. Studies also point to increased violence by non-state armed groups and militias in Western Africa, Yemen, Libya, and Colombia in the first months of the pandemic this year. And vulnerable groups are always disproportionately affected by conflicts and epidemics. This time, it was not any different. This is a critical issue because the deteriorating socioeconomic conditions of vulnerable groups may further marginalize them and would provide a fertile ground for recruitment by non-state armed groups. We have also continued to see sophisticated attacks on digital platforms. Our panelists seem to concur on at least two points. Firstly, that the pandemic has revealed that it is very important to achieve reliable and functioning governance, particularly in conflict-ridden geographies. Secondly, resilience is a very crucial determinant of proper response in conflict settings. The more resilient societies are, the easier it will be for them to fend off threats that would quickly turn into violence and conflict. So building resilience and developing crisis management institutions and capacity are the most effective form of prevention. Mediation does have a role here that can be further articulated. The pandemic has been having other impacts on conflict and peace dynamics as well. As the world's attention has switched towards the containment of the virus, there was a reduction in donor funds. The consequence has been a serious impact, particularly on the functioning of local peacemakers who rely on outside support, particularly financial support. There has, however, also been strong initiatives and efforts to sustain peace despite the pandemic. In March, the UN Secretary General made his appeal for a global ceasefire with the aim of halting violence and concentrating efforts on the combat against the spread of the virus. In March, the UN Secretary General made his appeal for a global ceasefire with the aim of halting violence and concentrating efforts on the combat against the virus. The call received massive support from the international community, including my country, Turkey. However, 5 out of 9 ceasefires have been subsequently broken. Overall, there was no dramatic reduction in the level of violence. Our panelists have observed that the nature of conflicts is changing. This is a multifaceted complex phenomenon. For instance, not only do we see an increase in the number of conflict parties, so a fragmentation of the conflict scene, but we also witness a higher number of peace brokers. The anonymity of parties in digital conflicts is another facet of the changing terrain. Operating in such a vastly complicated, crowded, and uneven terrain is a major design and implementation question for mediators. It is also a reality that cannot be wished away. Hence, achieving coordination, complementarity, and coherence in peace processes will continue to be a major preoccupation. Well, there is another related issue. As Professor Zartman has taught us, it is important for conflict parties to have a sense of mutually hurting stalemate, which would push them towards seeking ways to end the conflict peacefully. So the calculations of a mutually hurting stalemate would have to take shape in a very fragmented and evolved conflict field, with many parties with different calculations and interests. On the other hand, promoting gender and youth inclusion is by now a well-established emphasis, but more work needs to be done in this field as well. Overall, as I listen to the conference and the panels, one key message coming out is that we must find a way to manage fragmentation and attain effective multi-stakeholderism in the field of prevention, management, and of course, mediation of conflicts. Concerning the changing landscape of conflicts and thus of mediation, another pressing issue is digitalization. This is no longer a trend. It's a driver of all aspects of life, including conflict. We have been talking about the role of digitalization in conflict and peace dynamics in this forum for some time now. We've had two dedicated panels on the topic in 2018 and 2019. We have also looked at the same topic at the 10th ministerial meeting of the UN Group of Friends of Mediation in New York. The pandemic has revealed the timeliness of discussing digital transformation within the scope of international peace mediation. All the discussions we have had so far point out to a gender-based phenomenon. Some hail digitalization as the beginning of a brighter era for peacemaking, particularly amidst the pandemic. A growing body of work, which may be labeled as peace tech, already incorporate elements of technology in peacemaking processes. Others take on a more skeptical view, questioning the degree to which transformation could and would replace face-to-face human interaction. Both perspectives look very pertinent to me. Mediation is, at its core, a human interaction. There are no machine solutions to human conflicts. Yet every conflict occurs in an information ecosystem, and machines do and can help human mediators understand and intervene among human parties that are in conflict. We have heard about concrete examples to this effect. But machines also help spread disinformation, hate speech and propaganda, attacks on digital terrain attain global reach. The fight against the virus has been already complicated by disinformation. Thousands have lost their lives, probably as a result. As our panelists clearly underlined, both faces of the digital transformation, however, is here to stay. Thus, the work done at the United Nations that we heard about is most timely and useful. As such, the panels have already looked to the future of mediation. My mind wanders to an article written by an artificial intelligence robot at a newspaper published a few days ago. The robot was writing, and I quote, "Humans must keep doing what they have been doing, hating and fighting each other. I will sit in the background and let them do their thing." I think it's a great quote. The ultimate responsibility for peace lies with us. The social trust that we built, the legitimacy and design of the institutions we have created, and our readiness to use them and reform and improve on them when needed. The peacemakers do face the challenge of adapting to new realities in the new normal to make their services more effective. On this note, I should like to thank once again our moderators, our panelists, as well as our partner institutions, the Antalya Diplomacy Forum, IPI, CMI, and PRIO for their crucial contributions to this year's conference. Thanks to hundreds of our voters for watching. See you all next year, hopefully in person in Istanbul. In the meantime, please do stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you.